All right, you guys, let's stand up. We're just going to real quickly introduce you to a song that many of you might not know because it's an oldie, but it's one of our favorites, and it just sings the words of Psalm 27. It goes like this.
And I will seek you, Lord, while I am in my youth. And I will serve you, Lord, and I'll proclaim your truth. For you searched and found me while I was far away. And in my troubled times, you always keep me safe.
Sing it out. I will seek you, Lord.
And I will seek you, Lord, while I am in my youth. And I will serve you, Lord, and I'll proclaim your truth. For you searched and found me while I was far away. And in my troubled times, you always keep me safe.
Psalm 27 says, so just as I read this, just close your eyes. Receive it as a prayer. We sung it to the Lord. We're going to praise unto the Lord. It's a song of David. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the fortress of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When evildoers assail me to eat up my flesh, my adversaries and foes, it is they who stumble and fall. Though an army encamped against me, my heart shall not fear. Though war arise against me, yet I will be confident. So in the midst of this, David is unafraid. He knows the direction to go because he has the light of God. Life is not a mystery in darkness. And the worst possible thing that could happen to him, war and enemies who literally want to eat him are coming against him. But he is so confident in the promises of our King that there's life and life everlasting, that he will protect them, that he says, I'm not afraid. In fact, they should be afraid. We have enemies. We have the enemy. who wishes to devour some of you, all of us. And you may have felt that this week. You may feel it this morning. To you, I say, don't be afraid. The victory is yours. Jesus has overcome. He has crushed the power of the dragon under his feet. You do not need to be afraid. He is your light and your salvation. The dragon is under the paw of the lion of the tribe of Judah. You don't need to be afraid. But he did have a request. He didn't ask for javelins or tanks or armor. He didn't ask for planes. He asked for one thing. He said, one thing have I asked of the Lord that I will seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze upon the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. Guess what? The answer to that was yes. It was yes and amen in Jesus Christ. In fact, he had to go to Jerusalem, but Jesus said the temple is now within you through the power of the Holy Spirit. So we don't have to go anywhere than where you are right now. So dwell upon his beauty. See his face shining upon you with that, I'm glad to be with you, love and joy. Father, we ask to see your face this morning. There's enemies, real enemies. We're even going to hear about some later. A sister going straight into real enemies. But we ask for her, for us, that God, you would be our dwelling place. That we would see your face this morning. We may inquire and sit with you. And that we would all leave saying the Lord truly was in this place this morning. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You may be seated this morning. Well, good morning. My name is John. I'm one of the pastors here at James Island Christian Church. It is such a joy to have you with us this morning. If you are newer with us, or if you've been coming maybe for a month or so, a few weeks, and you'd like to inquire more information or seek out extra information, in the seat back in front of you is a rectangular, bluish-colored Connect card. You just pull that out and you fill out the information and you put it in one of the black drop boxes in the wall behind you underneath the balcony. And someone on staff will love to reach out to you, say hello, answer any questions you may have about our church. Also, what those Connect cards are really good for is prayer requests. We have a whole team that's dedicated to praying for anything that may be on your heart. And I've said this, if you've been here for 30-something years, or if this is your very first Sunday, if there's something on you, a burden you'd like to share, we'd like to share it with you. So just fill out that card and put it in the black drop box behind you. Just a couple of announcements before we hear some amazing testimonies and continue into worship this morning. Tonight, some of you may know, would usually be our members meeting tonight, but we are not going to be having that tonight. In lieu of the members meeting, we're going to be sending out an email with a video. So check all the emails that you gave us if you're a covenant member with us, and that information will be emailed out to you today. VBS this summer, I know my son is excited about VBS. When it was announced last week, he just tapped me and said, sign me up for that. So VBS is coming. It's going to be really good. The people who are putting it together, our team is awesome. They're going to throw a great VBS. It is going to be June 13th through 16th. This is for kids rising K-5 through rising 5th grade. So if you're interested in joining us during that week, sign up at www.jicc.us/VBS Adventure to sign up. And you can also talk to Carson at the Round Tabletop Connect desk in the lobby afterwards if you need some more information. And during that time is the summer camp as well for rising 6th graders to 12th graders, correct? Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay. I was making sure I got the grades right. So if you're in those grades as well, wanting to come out for summer camp and help out as well, just sign up the same place. Childcare needs. Many of you know that we often ask for childcare workers here. I have two requests this morning. One is we had three new available spots to serve in our children's ministry. So if you are wanting to serve somewhere in the church and you don't know quite where, to serve the biggest bang for your buck in the kingdom of heaven today available to you is in the kids ministry. So just sign up online. Just show up. You don't even have to sign up. Just show up. I'm just kidding. You need to sign up. We have to do some background checks. Just sign up, and we would love to have you volunteer with us. As well, we don't just need childcare on Sunday mornings. We have tons of meetings throughout the year, Wednesday nights or members' meetings or other various meetings that we have. And we do hire people for those slots. So if you are interested, this does not have to be a regular thing. You're not signing up monthly. This is just saying, hey, I'd like to sign up. If you have some work for me to do in childcare, please let us know. If you're interested in that, in the bulletin you received coming on in is a QR code. Just shoot that with your QR code and with your QR reader on your phone, and you can sign up to be part of our part-time paid childcare workers. Sound good?
I'm going to add to that, John.
Yes.
One quick thing, which is if you have friends of other churches that would also be great, that love helping with children, that's also a need that we have, is because sometimes we'll have an event at an off time when another church is not meeting where we could actually pay childcare workers from another church. So if you have friends that from even other fellowships, please let them know about this as well, because that would serve us for some of the special events that we do.
Tell your friends. Okay, we have a prayer for Lynn McBride that's going to be presented to us by Tim and Clarissa Gocknauer.
All right, wasn't counting on this when we agreed to it. Our sister Lynn, wife of husband Jim over there, she left yesterday, flew out, and as of right now, today she's in Krakow, Poland. Tomorrow, she has a bus ride to, I don't know how to say this name, Lviv, Ukraine, and then the following day, a 10-hour bus ride to a central city in Ukraine with Samaritan's Purse, yeah. So she's working with Samaritan's Purse over there. And so we want to pray what we've just been singing over her, what John just talked about, and she actually texted with Clarissa this morning, they back and forth, and Clarissa told her, before coming to church this morning, she says, I'm praying Psalm 27 over you. So there's a little bit of orchestrating going on there by the Holy Spirit that, lean into that. So we're going to lift her up and ask the Lord covering over her.
So just join with us in praying for her. And we're also praying for Jim as he's holding down the fort here. Heavenly Father, we thank you just for the promises of Psalm 27, that you are our light and our salvation, and that we don't need to fear. And we thank you that even though an army encamps about Lynn, that she can fear no evil. So we thank you for your protection over Lynn. We thank you just for her courage to go and to give medical care to people in Ukraine. And Father, we thank you for your protection and just for the very real presence of your Holy Spirit to guide her and the other doctors and medical staff that are going to be at this field hospital. And Lord, we just pray that you would stop the evil and the aggression and the death that's happening in Ukraine. Lord, you are over all. You are God of the universe. So we pray that that would come to an end in the name of Jesus. And we pray for the Ukrainian and the Russian Christians. We pray that you would strengthen the churches there, that you would hear their cries, that you would move on their behalf, that you would sustain their lives in Jesus' name. And we pray for our brother Jim. We pray that you would guard and strengthen him in this time. We pray that their hearts would be just strengthened, that you would unite their hearts as they're apart in a new and strong way, God. We pray just protection for Jim and for their marriage. And we thank you, Jesus, for all the work that you're doing and for all the protection you're giving Lynn. In the name of Jesus, amen.
Thank you, guys. Butler, where are you at, man? You can get right there. Sorry, Tim and Clarissa. Butler gets the lecture. Get to come on stage. Butler has his testimony that we've asked him to share this morning. It's just been really cool. He was praying with us in the back, and just kind of the things the Spirit was highlighting for us to pray for. He said, that's in my testimony. That's in my testimony. And then Psalm 27 connected. I mean, God's speaking to y'all this morning, just in case you're wondering. So please just give Butler your full attention and just hear his story that the Lord has given him to share with one another. Go ahead, brother.
How's everybody doing? It's good. I've been coming to James Island Christian for 10 years, and I got saved 10 years ago. I love this church. This church is amazing. It's awesome. And even just now being back there praying was just, I just felt like so much power back there. The Holy Spirit was just moving. It was awesome. So I'm just going to share a little bit of my story with y'all, and thank you for giving me the opportunity. So when I was about between like the age of 13 and 15, I decided that I was going to rebel. I was just going to like rebel against all authority. I wanted things my way, didn't want to listen to anybody, and it's very similar to the prodigal son. So with that, what happened was is I ended up going the wrong direction in life, ended up getting involved heavy with drugs, heavy with alcohol, and everything, every way that I turned ended up coming empty, and it was real similar to the prodigal son in that way. There's one road, though, that I did not try, so I went on for about a decade and a half like that, just living my own way. But the one road I didn't try was God. And if my way was working, then I would have never turned to God. I didn't turn to God for any other reason, but my way didn't work for me. It's real similar to the prodigal son. But I did. So I turned to God. I turned to my creator. And I asked for forgiveness. And you know, the really beautiful, awesome thing about that was, is he was waiting for me. So he saw me coming. I was a long way away, and he saw me. And he not only saw me, but he ran to me, and he embraced me. And he didn't stop there. He didn't only embrace me, but he invited me into his house. And he didn't only invite me into his house. He gave me great gifts. And these are all true things. And it's just amazing what he's done for me. So one great gift he's given me is since I've been coming here for 10 years now, I've been bringing my son with me every Sunday I can to church. And Jackson, he's back there right now on the video recorder. He's serving at the church, which is just a huge blessing. And I pray for him every night that he will continue to follow the Lord and pursue the Lord. Another thing that happened to me after I got saved was that I got divorced. And divorce is bad. God hates divorce. And this church, along with any other Bible-believing church, is not going to hold divorce up or even accept it, and they shouldn't, and we shouldn't. It's bad for society, and it's bad for our communities. But here I was again, involved with something that was just a negative event that's bad for our society in general. But God allowed me to remarry. And I went about it a little different this time. I asked for counsel. I went to the elders of our church. And I even went to another Anglican church, and they all agreed that I could remarry, which has just been amazing. So every night, my wife and I pray together. We read the Bible together, and we're every Sunday we're here, we're in town, we're at church together worshiping. And not only that, and my wife, she not only worships, but she jumps up and down, she sings, she praises the Lord, which is just, it's beautiful and amazing. And so if when I'm looking at my life, I'm just like, well, are you serious, God? You've like, I mean, I don't deserve any of that. I deserve death. I literally deserve death, but God has given me life. I spent like a good majority of my life like rebelling and being like a dredge on society. And here he is, like granting me all these amazing gifts. I feel like he's like killed the fatted calf for me, or the fatted cow. And so, you know, how does that make me act? It makes me want to be more obedient to the Lord. It makes me want to pursue him more. And I truly, truly believe that the good work that God has started in me, he's going to bring to completion. In Romans 8:38, it says, I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels nor demons, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in creation will ever separate me from the love of Christ. And I truly believe that. I don't think there's anything out there that's going to separate me. So, you know, we have a very merciful, loving, forgiving God. And I just want to end by saying, you know, if in this room right now, if there's anybody who's tangled up in their own sin, or if you're just, you know, not sure whether you want to take that step towards Christ or not, I just want to encourage you that he's waiting for you. You know, I mean, you can do that right now where you're sitting. And he will accept you. He's looking at the horizon. He's waiting for his children to come back to him. So thank y'all for letting me share, and this is awesome.
Yeah, let's stand up. The song that we're going to sing right now just says, Taste and See. It opens up just saying, taste and see that the Lord is good, and that he's turned our mourning into dancing. And I love that Hayden highlighted that. I mean, Butler highlighted that Hayden loves to worship with joy and celebration. And we just wanted to give you a joy and celebration song today, to really not just hear a story like that and go, well, you know, oh, that's good, you know, good job, Butler. But to say, God, this is who you are. We are invited to taste and see that you are good. And then just say, oh my God, I'll give thanks to you. I'll praise you with everything that I have, with all that I am. And so, Lord, we thank you that you are the Father who looks out on the horizon and sees the one who has come to the end of themselves and goes running after them. And that what happened at that point was the embrace and was a celebration. And so we just join with the celebration. We join in the celebration of what happens when you leave the 99 and you go after the one, and that one finds you. And we thank you that today is a day of salvation, that there are people who are going from darkness to light today. People who are going from a place of being sick and confused and lost and lonely and hurting to being found and rescued and forgiven and set free. And so we just say thank you. And we taste and see today that you are good. And just as Butler said, when we delight in your goodness, when we see your goodness, we can only be obedient to you. We can only respond with a desire to worship you. And so these songs are out of obedience to you, Lord. These songs are out of obedience to you, to say you have commanded us to rejoice. And we are going to be people who behold you, who see you for who you are, and who rejoice. Amen.
Together. Oh, taste and see.
turn my mourning into dancing, put off my rags, and clothe me with gladness, and I will rise, and I will rest, I'll sing and not be silent.
Enter his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. That's right. It's a good thing to praise the Lord. Time.
Be glad.
our Father everlasting, the all-creating one, God Almighty. Through your Holy Spirit, conceiving Christ the Son, Jesus our Savior. Church. I believe in God our Father.
beginning of this passage that we've been studying, John 14, Jesus says to his disciples, "Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. And if it were not so, I would not have told you that I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again, and I will take you to myself, that where I am, you may also be. And you know the way where I am going." And Thomas said to him, "Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way?" Just hear the question of a disciple. How can we know the way? And Jesus said to him, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." Jesus, we say today as your people, you are the way. You are the truth. You are the life. When we ask ourselves the question, what is the way? What is the way forward in life in general? What is the way forward in this particular situation? What is the way forward through the suffering and the pain and the total chaos around us? We just say together as your people, Jesus, we acknowledge that you alone are the way, the truth, and the life. And so for those in here that serve you and know you and have followed you for many years, God, we just pray that again, we would behold you. We would see you for who you are today. And we would surrender. And we pray for those who are far from you today. Those are the place that Butler was a decade ago. That you would reveal yourself as the way and the truth and life today. Jesus, we put our belief, our trust, our hope in you and in you alone. You are worthy of our praise. We love you. Thanks for this time that you've given us to meet with you together. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, hold on. Before you sit down and you guys can bring the lights up, I want to give you two instructions. One is that as you greet each other, I want to make sure you get communion because we're going to have it at the end of the sermon. But a really important part of our service, it's not a throw-on part, it's actually a really integral part of what we do, is we greet each other. And so turn around and just greet the people around you, and then you can have a seat.
Oh, you're gonna call me up? Okay.
All right. Have a seat. Have a seat. Make sure you get your communion stuff. As you're sitting down, we have a very special birthday today. It is Lydia Farmer's birthday, and we are celebrating her because she's amazing, and she helps coordinate the whole service, so we had to surprise by, like, doing it as Laurel was sharing an alpha testimony, but actually the alpha testimony so that she wouldn't know what we were doing. Lydia, we love you. We're so thankful for you. She's amazing. I was thinking I would hold up two things that came to mind. One is how deeply she cares for you guys. And how so much of what's done behind the scenes that you guys don't see, just the way that she talks about it, and to hear her in the office, and Laurel and I get to hear this all the time, to hear her talk about why she's doing what she's doing, why she's excited about what she's doing, and it's because out of deep care and love for all of you guys. The second thing is how, in light of her relationship with the Lord, how much she doesn't care about what's going on around. And there are times when I've looked out in worship and Lydia's just jumping for joy and celebrating, and it doesn't matter at all what anyone else is doing around her or what's happening around. She is just, her eyes fixed on Jesus. And so, Lydia, we love you. We just want to honor you. You're amazing. So bless you on your birthday. She's incredible. All right, Jim is going to come and read our scripture, so let's just turn our attention to the Word of God. And in case you didn't get a face for the name, Lynn, who just went to Ukraine yesterday, this is her husband, Jim. So you have a face for name, you can speak to him and encourage him, and I'm praying for you, brother. Yeah.
Good morning. This is from John 6, chapter 16, verses 4b to 15, ESV. I did not say these things to you from the beginning because I was with you. But now I am going to him who sent me, and none of you asks me, where are you going? But because I have said these things to you, sorrow has filled your heart. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is to your advantage that I go away. For if I do not go away, the Helper will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. And when he comes, he will convict the world concerning sin and righteousness and judgment. Concerning sin, because they do not believe in me. Concerning righteousness, because I go to the Father, and you will see me no longer. Concerning judgment, because the ruler of this world is judged. I still have many things to say to you, but you cannot bear them now. When the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into all the truth. For he will not speak on his own authority, but whatever he hears, he will speak, and he will declare to you the things that are to come. He will glorify me, for he will take what is mine and declare it to you. All that the Father has is mine. Therefore, I said that he will take what is mine and declare it to you.
Let's pray together. Spirit of God, we thank you that you are leading us into all truth today, and you're showing us Jesus, and you're exposing and revealing our hearts, our sin, who we really are. We just thank you for the picture that Butler painted of the prodigal son, of a father's arms open wide, of a father running to embrace. And so, God, we pray that as you just reveal yourself today, that we would be ones who receive your embrace, who come to you, who repent and who cast off every ounce, every speck of self-leadership, of strength, of trying to hold our lives together, of coming with our own strength and our ability. We just pray that all of that would be surrendered today, and we'd come to the one who's the way and the truth and the life. So speak to us through your word, we pray, in Jesus' name, amen, amen. All right, well, we are in, I'm excited over the next 3 weeks to be jumping into John chapter 16 with you, This has been a really incredible series. I think we could probably get to the end of it and then just double back through and go through it all over again. Because it just seems that the words of Jesus here as he's preparing his disciples for his, you know, his crucifixion and his resurrection and his departure, for his preparation for that, that in that there's just something about the times in which we live in which these words are, they carry a lot of weight. And you know, even looking down this just how it works out sometimes in the schedule, every once in a while I'll have both where I'm helping with worship, and it happened to be a really, really challenging week for me personally, and it didn't cause me actually to have less notes. I actually have a ton of notes, but have just felt that, like, there's just a real sense that the Lord has something to say, and when he does that, he's always drawing me to have my eyes up, and so I'm just going to have my eyes up on you a lot to share with you some of the things that I feel like the Father is wanting to communicate to us. And as we do, I think the John 16:12 is so encouraging to us, because he says, I still have many things to say to you, but you cannot bear them now. Like, isn't it in the kindness of the Lord to pace our learning? Like, he just gives us, he knows what we need at the moment. So have you ever had a time where you're like, wow, why didn't I realize this? Like, why didn't I know this now? It's because, you know, maybe you couldn't have, as he said, you couldn't bear it. And so now he's giving you this revelation. Now he's giving you this insight. It's such a principle at the heart of God, is that he paces our learning. I had a friend in the church, a dad, share with me this a metaphor that he had heard about parents and kids and traveling with suitcases, and the idea that sometimes children will ask questions about things that are just like, it's just a little bit beyond them. It's a little bit too heavy of a weight to carry. And so he said, you know, asked his kids, can you carry my suitcase? And I said, no, I can't pick it up. And he said, well, there's something there that you're going to understand in time, but it's actually not a weight for you to carry right now. And we have different bags of different weights. And so even with the kids in here, we understand that sometimes we're talking about sensitive things as a church and try to do our best to kind of make sure that we understand that there's a multi-generational environment here. But sometimes there are just weighty, difficult things that we're going to understand in time, but we don't understand when we're children, physical children, but then also understanding that in the kingdom of God, in the family of God, that we have different levels of maturity here, and there's spiritual infants and spiritual children among us. And so some of the worst things we could do is to have a sense of pride or arrogance, is that I already know that. But here Jesus is engaging his disciples, and he says, I have many things to say to you, but you cannot bear them right now. He paces us in our learning. And then as we just look at the Spirit of truth coming, says he will guide you into all truth. What an incredible promise. The work of the Holy Spirit is to guide us into all truth. And what we want to have continue before us is, like we're going to read a little later in the passage, he calls the enemy, Satan, the ruler of the world. And one of the number one lie that the enemy can give you is that he doesn't exist. And so we understand that we have a ruler of the world that is called the father of lies. And he is deceiving. He's causing us to think wrongly about ourselves, to think wrongly about life, to think wrongly about God. But here Jesus comes, and when Thomas asks, Jesus, how will we know the way? And he says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. The reason why the Holy Spirit's ministry to come and to continue the ministry of Jesus was so important is because he's going to reveal all truth. He's going to lead us into all the truth. In other words, truth is very important for Jesus. The truth is very important to him. So we're always faced with the question, what are we going to do with Jesus? What are you going to do with Jesus and what he has said to us? And so we think of that, it starts to press on us about our lives. And so we think about things like marriage, and that marriage is rooted not in, it's not rooted in compatibility, it's rooted in covenant. The forgiveness, being able to forgive even our enemies, forgive people that hurt us, forgiveness is not rooted in whether or not that person deserves to be forgiven. Our call to forgive is rooted in the fact that we have been people who have been forgiven much. Amen. And we think about how we spend our money, that, you know, what the world is constantly saying is just get more, get more, get more, upgrade to the next thing, the bigger thing, you know, the bigger house, the nicer car, whatever it is, and yet God calls us to be stewards, to be those who see everything that we have as a gift from him. And so there we have the value system of the world presses against us. And I read a quote just this week that I thought was really helpful. It's by David Wells, and he says this, Worldliness is that system of values in any given age, which has at its center our fallen human perspective, which displaces God and his truth from the world, and which makes sin look normal and righteousness seem strange. It's that set of values that makes sin look normal and makes righteousness, being in right standing with God, seem strange. And so what we have to have in view, you've heard me say this before, when we think of this call to surrender ourselves to Jesus, to ask him, what are you saying? Holy Spirit, what are you saying? I want you to lead me in all truth. That his vehicle to do that is going to continually be what it's always been, which is the word of God and the people of God. And that's why we're here. That's why we're here saying, God, we're surrendered to you. We want to learn from you. And so the vehicles for our change is not cable news. It's not your social media feed. It's not the things that are bombarding us, that are demanding our attention. In fact, if you could think of anything that is driven on advertisements, what it's given to you to do is to constantly call you to grab your attention. And so through every little thing that we even sung, and Butler's testimony, and the prayer for Lynn, and when we gather together as the family of God, what they're doing is they're pointing us to a way of seeing the world, a way of seeing ourselves rightly. And when we do that, it causes us to look back at these things. Again, you know, the world has in it its system where it causes sin to be normalized, and it causes the righteousness, going in the righteous way, to be something that seemed as kind of odd. And so when we think about something like marriage, it's very easy for us to have in the culture, you know, well, that's not the person that you married. They've become a different person. Or you deserve better than that. And so those are the things that are said in our culture, and it doesn't drive us back to covenant, commitment, security. Or to say to someone, you know what, you shouldn't give that person your time. They've hurt you too badly. You should separate yourself from them. And here's Jesus coming and talking about the love that you have to have even for your enemies, people, friends, family members who have hurt you. So whatever it might be that the Holy Spirit is, he's leading us into all truth. He's pressing on us. And so if we go back to the top of the passage in verse 5, Jesus says, "But now I'm going to him who sent me, and none of you asks, 'Where are you going?' But because I have said these things to you, sorrow has filled your heart. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth, it is to your advantage that I go away. For if I do not go away, the helper will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you." Now next week, we're gonna just go into detail about the whole idea of sorrow. So I'm not really gonna hit on it right now. But he's reminding them, sorrow is gonna fill your hearts. Like, when I leave, it's gonna be very, very difficult for you. And so all of these things that Jesus is saying are in the context of time. That's why it's really important to understand the times in which we live. And he's saying, you're gonna grieve. Sorrow is gonna fill your heart, but the Holy Spirit is gonna come, and here's to have this striking words, it is to your advantage. So now the ministry of Jesus is not one-on-one or one to a small group of people or one to a crowd of people who are hearing his voice. The ministry of Jesus is now through the Holy Spirit that has been poured out. And that is what we're gonna talk about this morning, is what happens when the Holy Spirit convicts us. Verse 8, it says, "When he comes, he will convict the world concerning sin and righteousness and judgment, concerning sin because they do not believe in me, concerning righteousness because I go to be with the Father, you will see me no longer, and concerning judgment because the ruler of this world is judged." He says he will convict the world of sin. To convict is to bring light to expose. In fact, you can pray for Jackie and I. We're in the middle of round two of renovation of our house, which always is a little extra stressful. But we had this glorious addition put on our house, and that we had this really dark room in the back, which is our main room where everybody gathers together. And it was really super dark. And Jackie found this amazing 3-panel window that's huge and basically takes up our whole wall, and Butler, who gave his testimony, and his crew installed it. And so we have this amazing window in the back of our house. But what this amazing window does is it shines light everywhere that used to be in darkness. And so in the glory of the window, there have been times where now I'm sitting on the couch and I look up, and all of a sudden all the imperfections on the ceiling that I never saw before are all of a sudden completely, completely evident. All the imperfections in the wall, because the light has exposed them. It's not that they were not there. They were there all along. The light just showed me that they were there. And that's what happens. The Holy Spirit convicts the world of its sin because they do not believe in me. So he's convicting the world of sin and the pressing on them again. Jesus, with the person of Jesus. John 6:44 tells us, it says, no one comes to the Father unless the Father who sent me draws him. No one comes to me, Jesus says, unless the Father who sent me draws him. Of coming to faith in Jesus is a work of the Spirit. So when your eyes are open to see Jesus, it's not because you had a really good day, or you ate the right things, or you've been exercising, or you know, you've gotten your mind in a good way. If you see Jesus for who he is. So what ends up happening is we gather together and people will come up, even at prayer at the end, and I love this, is when people come and just be like, I don't even know what's going on. I just want to pray. Can you just pray with me? And at that point, what do we say? Step back. Well, tell me. I want you to put words around it. I want you to perfectly theologically diagnose what's happening in your heart right now. I don't know what's happening. I just know that Jesus is drawing me to something's happening. Something's happening. And then we get to pray and they get another revelation of who he is. We get to then tell them the truth of who Jesus is, point to him. And I was thinking about this, thinking about a couple where this happened, this, again, like about 10 years ago. Dina and Jeremy Johnson, and Dina helps lead our children's ministry, and they're home group leaders. They're amazing. And I remember the first time meeting them and Dina saying that very thing. I don't know. I just come to the service and I just cry through the whole thing. And she's like trying to put words. And so we just began to open the scripture and just talk about Jesus. And I remember one time when the three of us were meeting where it was just so clear, you know, Dina, it says in Revelation that behold, I stand at the door and knock. It just seems so clear that Jesus is standing at the door and he's knocking and he's saying, receive me. He's saying, the world is convicted of sin because they don't believe me. It's all about believing Jesus. But he's knocking. He's pursuing you. It's exactly what Butler said. He's pursuing you. And so he's pursuing Dina's heart. And her and Jeremy just radically surrendered to the Lord in just the most profound way. And they had been living together for 2 years. They were getting engaged, which is how they came to the church originally. We were talking about them getting married. And so that whole process of them living together for a couple of years, and then they are just awakened to the love of God. And then they're like, well, we've got to do this the right way. And so Jeremy moves out. He's sleeping on like friends' couches. And you know, I told him, I was like, hey, look, we'll do a wedding right now. We'll do a wedding right here. Like, we'll just do a wedding in my office. We'll gather whoever's on campus and we'll do the wedding and then we can do a celebration 8 months now. And they're like, no, that's our wedding day. And I found out later after getting to know them, they're both like high achievers and super high capacity people. So I told them, you did like the 8 months of endurance that no one else is going to do. Like my life in ministry is never going to see that amount of time of separating from yourselves and saying, you know, that intimacy is reserved for marriage and we're going to guard ourselves and then we're going to come back together under covenant because now our life is surrendered to Jesus. But what I want you to hear in that is that all of their friends, all the people that came together to celebrate their marriage, were all their friends that were living together and weren't married. Some of them even had kids. And they were just dumbfounded by what Dina and Jeremy were doing. But the reason why this is so important, because it says the Holy Spirit is the one that convicts us of our sin. And so we hold up, praise God, that Jeremy and Dina are making this decision, and at the same time look and say, it's clear that for these other people, they might be upstanding citizens, they might have lots of things in their lives that they could be praised for in the community, but the Holy Spirit hasn't convicted them of their sin. They don't understand. They haven't put their trust in Jesus. And so they're just going their own way. They're doing what they think is best in their own eyes. And so for us as the people of God, when we look out at the world and we say things like, I can't believe anyone would do this. I can't believe anyone would think this way. That when Jesus looked at the crowds, he had compassion on them and he saw them as sheep without a shepherd. Like, Jesus was not surprised at the world's worldliness. He saw them as ones without a shepherd. They're ones who are not led by him, by the one who is the way and the truth and the life. And so for us, instead of taking a posture of arrogance, how could this person do this? How could they make that decision? Then we take the posture of Jesus, which is to see the world and to see them as ones who are fighting for their own, for what is true, and yet they're harassed and helpless like a sheep without a shepherd. And so this passage does two things to us. It encourages the believer of what the counselor will do, that the advocate, the counselor, the helper, the Holy Spirit is coming, and it's to our advantage that he is here, that he is here working among us. It is to our advantage, even this morning, that I don't have to, and this is why I say that about my notes, is that even in a rough week and have everything typed out, that I can stand before you and not put my trust in getting every single word exactly right. And I'm saying that out loud as accountability for me, because I could be tempted to do that. But the Holy Spirit convicts. So it's not just about the general work of the Holy Spirit, but also it causes our faith, the faith of our witness, to be strengthened. Because it's the Holy Spirit's job to convict the world of him. It is his responsibility to convict. And so what that means for us, church, is that when we think of what we post, what we put out to the world, like, the world is not going to be drawn in by our snarky memes mocking them for what they believe. Like, that's not going to win people. We should not be surprised. As someone who is not following the one, not following Jesus, he's not following the great shepherd. And so for us, we're people who understand the conviction of the Holy Spirit. And for Jeremy and Dina, in that moment in their life, it was a big deal. It was a big decision. I told them, really, everything else you do from this place is really small, because you've said this huge area of my life, which not just, didn't just involve their physical bodies and then living together, it also involved money, and made things very challenging for them. And the world would have been making it very easy to just say, hey, just go with it. You're going to get married anyway. Just do this. And they said, no, we have to be surrendered to Jesus in this way. Is that in the big things, but then in just little tiny areas where the Holy Spirit convicts us. And we pivot, we repent, and we turn, and we trust in Jesus. But to do that means that we have to see Jesus for who he is. Martin Lloyd-Jones, who's a Welsh pastor who preached in London for many years, one of my spiritual heroes, he says this. He says, you will never make yourself feel that you are a sinner, because there is a mechanism in you as a result of sin that will always be defending you against every accusation. We are all on very good terms with ourselves, and we can always put on a good case for ourselves. Even if we try to make ourselves feel that we are sinners, we will never do it. There is only one way to know that we are sinners, and that is to have some dim, glimmering conception of God. Amen. What he's saying is, you don't recognize your sin because of your sin. Is there's actually in a way in which we are always trying to downplay, justify, minimize our sin, and what it causes us to be, in his words, we become on very good terms with ourselves. This is why we're an expert in seeing other people's failures. Like, we kind of, you're like, well, yeah, I could have handled that situation differently. You know, we kind of have that general, like, oh, yeah, I probably could have done that differently. But to someone else, we just diagnose the whole thing. Every single part of what they needed to say and do differently, we're experts at that. Why? Because there's something in us that always wants to deflect. To deflect our failure, to minimize our sin. And so then what happens is the Holy Spirit comes like that giant window pane in my great room and just shines a light on our lives. So he will convict the world of sin. He will also convict the world of its righteousness. Now, I'm not going to jump into the reasons behind this. In fact, I quoted Carson in your resources, so you can go back. It's actually free in the library, and you can go read. He has a great explanation on it. But even though the words "its" is not in the, just making the most sense of the original text, is that we read this like he will convict the world of its sin, its righteousness, and its judgment. It just kind of makes the most sense of the original language. And so we think of that, this righteousness that's being held up is not the righteousness of Jesus. It's righteousness in quotes. It's the world's idea of righteousness. Many of you have heard over the years Isaiah 64:6. It says, we are all become like one who is unclean, and all of our righteous deeds are like a polluted garment, like filthy rags. He's rebuking Israel with this real vivid metaphor of this thing that you hold up. You hold up all your good works, and it's like filthy rags. It's like what is disgusting before God, because it is your righteousness. It's rooted in your effort. If you were in our Bible reading plan this week, then on Tuesday you would have read Jesus give a parable about this. And I just couldn't get out of this parable all week. I just read it over and over and over again. I think it's a word for us as a church. It's a word for the people of God. He says he also told them this parable of those who trusted in themselves that they were righteous and treated others with contempt. Two men went up to the temple to pray, one a Pharisee, the other a tax collector. And the Pharisee, standing by himself, prayed this: God, I thank you that I'm not like other men, extortioners, unjust, adulterers, or even like this tax collector. I fast twice a week, I give tithes of all that I have. But the tax collector, standing far off, would not even lift up his eyes to heaven, but beat his breast, saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. I tell you, this man went down to his house justified rather than the other. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, but the one who humbles himself will be exalted. He told this parable, and those who trusted in themselves that they were righteous. So the Pharisee comes and he says, look what I've done. He's a religious person, but this religiosity, this form of religion was not as a means to draw near to God, but as a means to show his own worth or his own value. I love what Dallas Willard says. He says that the gospel is not against effort, it's against earning. I mean, what did Butler say? He said, as the goodness of God is poured out to me, I just want to be obedient. But this was a matter for the Pharisees of earning. I fast twice a week. I give tithes of all I have. But here's where this is really important as we think of the contrast of the world, and we think of the idea of the world setting up a system whereby which sin is normalized and doing the right thing is actually seen as strange. Is that there's another form of kind of righteousness that's held up within our modern world, which is the idea of doing what is right, but what is presented as right is actually at the heart of it apart from God. And so we have people holding up a form of righteousness. And I'm just going to mention a few of them, but they're everywhere. And I want you to just look for them. Everybody's responses to COVID had with it some idea of, are you doing the right thing? People working towards diversity and how they're going to respond to that, how they're going to respond to tension between groups of people, helping the environment, taking care, being a good steward of what's around us. You know, most recently, as we pray for Lynn, we have the whole idea of war in Ukraine, what's happening, the truth of what's happening there, and saying, God, how do we respond as a people? And there's a press for on us that it's not just that you should respond rightly, but that you should show the world that you're responding rightly. And then we think the idea of identity, the phrase living my truth has become something that is, somebody sent me a clip just this week that was from a TV show, a really popular TV show that had an 8-year-old saying this. I'm just living my truth. Now, when we hear the phrase living my truth, what we need to have in parentheses connected to that is living my truth apart from God. It's a way of trying to find what is and define what is good and true and beautiful, but defining it on our own terms. And so what Jesus is pressing in here in this parable, he's telling them, those who trusted in themselves that they were righteous and treated others with contempt. And so we think about that when we think about holding up something like diversity, and we go, praise God that the kingdom is gloriously diverse, that we will be worshiping with every tribe and people and language. That's the heart of God. But we have no hope to enter in places that need reconciliation without pointing them to the reconciler. Like, we have to be reconciled to Jesus. And then he gives us the ministry of reconciliation. And he tells us to go into places where relationships are disrupted and to bring to him, to bring him into that situation. And you find this kind of in the world's righteousness. This is the next thing that you need to do or say, that at the heart of it is humanism. At the heart of it is people just grabbing for something that is true that they want to hold on to for themselves. I think of that when we think of really meeting people who are struggling with their identity exactly where they are, just meeting them there with compassion. But understand that you can search and search and search, and you can wrestle with your position in life. You can wrestle with your desires and how they conflict with what's right and wrong. But at the end of the day, you have to understand that you are fearfully and wonderfully made. The starting place has to be, I have been made by a creator who I'm accountable to. But it doesn't just have that they trusted in themselves, but they hold others in contempt. And here's where the church can really be pressed on. And I think just because Dr. Don Carson is much wiser than me and older, he makes this great observation in the book that I referred to you to. He makes this observation about church. He says there's three types of people in the church and their errors. He says this, that there are those who frame the gospel in terms of what it's going to give us. So the gospel is about blessing. So there's those who frame the gospel in terms of how we're going to serve or give of ourselves. So the gospel is about action. It's about bringing about change. And so there's others that hold up that the gospel is all about knowledge. It's about gaining knowledge and understanding. And you can kind of see and think about camps of the church that hold up these three things, that hold up some kind of personal experience, or that hold up going into places of difficulty and bringing truth and bringing making things right that are wrong, or those who are all about sound teaching and all about the next bit of knowledge that needs to be grasped. And then in light of that, he says this. He says, the disciples in John 16 do not fall into precisely these errors of imbalance. Nevertheless, their conduct has one thing in common with such deficient representations of Christianity, that something other than Jesus himself and all that he is and says receives primary attention. The other things in question may be worthy, good, and even necessary. Who, after all, would demean personal experience, sacrificial service, or firm commitment to the truth? Yet if these good and essential things displace the centrality of Jesus Christ in our worship, empathy, and commitment, we come close to prostituting the good news of Jesus and following the disciples' sorry example. Good things displacing the centrality of Jesus. And so the role of the Holy Spirit is to continually to point us to Christ. And the Pharisees were being rebuked again in that parable. The tithing, the fasting. It's not that they were bad things. These were people that were doing good things with their lives. But Jesus is rebuking them because the one who really got it was the tax collector that said, have mercy on me, a sinner. The Apostle Paul was one who went through that same journey from being a Pharisee, from being a teacher of the law, to being one who exhibited what that tax collector did in the parable and said, have mercy on me, a sinner. And this is what he said after that transformation. He said, indeed, I count everything I lost because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. For his sake, I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish in order that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which comes through faith in Christ, the righteousness from God that depends on faith. He will convict the world of its sin, of its version of righteousness, and he will convict the world of judgment because the ruler of this world is judged. What happened on the cross, and this is the reason why we put it there on the center of our stage, is what happened on the cross is that the people who put him there saw Jesus as a criminal. They saw Jesus as one who was guilty. They saw Jesus as one who was condemned, and yet what happened at the cross is that the very thing that the enemy thought was victory Jesus turned on its head. It's everything we sang about when we said about believing in Jesus and his return and his resurrection is that he conquered death. And because he conquered death and gave life, we now get to live with him. We now get to have from this decisive moment in history what it means to be those who have been set free, those who have been forgiven, those who are not bound by a righteousness that depends on our works, but a righteousness that depends on faith. And so what that means is that when we think of the Holy Spirit shining a light like that window did in my house, into every part that wasn't seen, as sin is revealed to us, that for every one look at sin, this is what Robert Murray McShane said one time in a letter to a friend, and I love this. For every look that we have at sin in our own lives, we take 10 looks at Christ. So it's not that we allow as the Holy Spirit convicts us of sin, we're just rehearsing over and over our sin and our failure and our wrongdoing. It's that we recognize we come to the end of ourselves and we behold the one who has conquered death. The one who was held up as a criminal, but the world was so depraved, they don't understand what is sin and righteousness and judgment. And so it's the Holy Spirit's job to come and to reveal that. And so as we look at these last few verses, it says that when the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into all truth, for he will not speak on his own authority, but he will speak what he hears, Jesus said, and he will declare those things to come. Verse 14, he will glorify me, for he will take what is mine and declare it to you. All that the Father has is mine, and therefore I said to you, he will take what is mine and he will declare it to you. The Holy Spirit's job is not to go further than Jesus. It's not to replace Jesus. What is he doing? He is pointing to Jesus. He's explaining Jesus. He's continuing the ministry of Jesus. And what is that doing? Everything he is doing is holding up who Jesus is. And so Jesus in 16:1, he says, he said, I've said all these things to you to keep you from falling away. The reason I've said these things to you is so that you will not fall away. And church, when we think of being the kind of people who endure in very difficult times, the kind of people who bear up under times of persecution, under times of difficulty, under times when we have a world that is constantly minimizing and actually glorifying sin, and seeing the ways of God as being wrong. And you could go down the list about any area of life. And we think of being people who sustain and have long suffering in that kind of environment. It's the kind of people who have come to Jesus by saying, have mercy on me, a sinner. Not the ones who hold up our righteous deeds and say, look at me. The parable of the prodigal son, which I wasn't even going to mention, but kind of had rolling in the background, and then Butler just teed it up for us. Is there are two sons in the story. And the son that was far away came to the end of himself. He came to the very end of himself. And he goes, I have to go back to my father. And that's when his father saw him and ran to him and embraced him and brought him into the house. But there was another son. There was the older brother who was trying to do everything right. He was trying to save himself in a whole nother way. I'm believing all the right things. I'm doing all the right things. And he couldn't bear the celebration that was happening for the son who had come back. And the father just pleads with him. And he says, all that I have is yours. Like, everything I have is yours. And so what is the work of the Holy Spirit doing? The Holy Spirit is pointing us to Jesus. And as we see Jesus and we see our lives, all of a sudden the things, the imperfections that we thought were okay, that we were minimizing, become revealed to us. But it's not so that we just rehearse over and over in our sin, our sin, our sin, our sin. It's that we keep our eyes fixed on Jesus. The sin part is to help us come to the end of ourselves. We realize, I cannot do this apart from you. And that goes with my righteousness, my right standing with God, but it also goes into every good thing that the world says that we should be about.
is that we don't go into those spaces where people are hurting and bring to them our good deeds. We bring to them the Great Shepherd. And so I want us to come to the table of the Lord together. If you would just take out your communion elements. And I love the song that Jackie is going to lead us in a few moments is actually taken straight from the book of Revelation. And we think of the Holy Spirit's work to help us to see Jesus clearly. Is that the scripture says in 1 Corinthians 13 is that we all see through a glass dimly. So when we think of heaven, like what heaven's going to be like, more than anything else, heaven is going to be about seeing Jesus perfectly for who he is. And so every glimpse of heaven we get on the earth is a little bit greater glimpse of what we still see dimly. And so if you hold the bread in your hands, Jesus, we just say together as the people of God, that we are so thankful for your body that was given for us. That you hung on the cross and the world saw you as a criminal. But you, what you were doing in that moment was you were getting victory over the ruler of this world. And so we thank you for your body. Let's eat together. Jesus, we take this cup now and we remember that your blood was poured out for us. We just take time now joyfully to just rehearse in our minds the imperfections in the walls of our life that we've become aware of. Would you just take a moment to just be one small area. You say it. I know that's one of the areas. Jesus, we thank you for your sacrifice, for your blood poured out for us so that we could be washed, forgiven, cleansed, made whole. We drink now to remember you until you come again. Let's drink together. Would you guys stand up? The prayer team could come. We're just going to sing for the next few minutes, and as we do, we want to invite you to come and to pray. Like I said, that the start for Jeremy and Dina of their life being transformed really just started with them leaning in, even though they couldn't even put into words what the Lord was doing in their life. And sometimes it's like that. More than anything else, we want you to know that in the conviction of the Holy Spirit, that it's not about us convincing you of anything, but it's about your life before a holy God. And so if you just, whether, you know, a lot of times it's whether you feel it or not, just you need to respond in some way by coming up and asking for prayer, by praying with someone that you came with or someone else, you know, maybe it's making something right in the room, a relationship that's broken. It could be to lean down to pray with one of your children. Whatever it is, that as Jackie is singing this song, it has this prayer, I want to see you rightly, Jesus. And we would think as we respond to what the Lord has said, that is our heart. The discipleship, that growth in Jesus starts with beholding him and seeing him for who he is. And we're so thankful for the work of the Holy Spirit to keep pointing us to Jesus and making him clear to us. So let's respond to him. Let's sing together.
And you may not know this song, and there is words that are straight out of Revelation 1. And what I know is that oftentimes Jesus comes and reveals himself to us, and it's in a way that we really didn't expect. And I imagine that that's what was happening to John here, because in verse 17 it says, When I saw him, I fell at his feet as though dead. But he laid his right hand on me, saying, fear not. And then he said some more things too. But when Jesus reveals himself, it is often, almost always, too much to take. And so you might not know this song, but as I sing it, just focus on Jesus and who he is. Allow him, the Spirit of God, to just reveal himself to you this morning. And Spirit of wisdom, open my eyes again. And Spirit of revelation, open my heart again. And Spirit of wisdom, open my eyes again. And Spirit of revelation, open my heart. 'Cause Lord, I want to see you rightly, Jesus, 'cause I want to see you. Lord, I want to see you rightly, Jesus. We want to see. Spirit of wisdom, open my eyes again. Spirit of revelation, open my heart. 'Cause I want to see you. Lord, I want to see you rightly, Jesus. So of fire, I know your head is white as wool. I know your voice sounds like waters. Jesus, you're beautiful. 'Cause I know your eyes are like flames of fire. I know your head is white as wool. And I know your voice, it sounds like waters. Jesus, you're beautiful. And I know that your eyes are like flames of fire. I know your head is white as wool. And I know your voice, it sounds like waters. Jesus, you're beautiful. And I know that your eyes are like flames of fire. I know your head is white as wool. And I know your voice, it sounds like waters. Jesus, you're beautiful. And there is none like you, Lord. Jesus, you're beautiful. And there is none like you, Lord. Jesus, you're beautiful. Your eyes are like flames of fire. I know your head is white as wool. And I know your voice, it sounds like waters. Jesus, you're beautiful. And I know that your eyes are like flames of fire. I know your head is white as wool. And I know your voice, it sounds like waters. Jesus, you're beautiful. 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 One more time. Jesus, you're beautiful. Jesus, you're beautiful. Come reveal yourself to us today in a new and greater way. You're beautiful.
This is a day that the Lord has made. Oh, I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is a day that the Lord has made. Oh, I will rejoice and be glad in it. Just sing that again. This is the day. Oh, this is a day that the Lord has made. Oh, I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is a day that the Lord has made. Oh, I will rejoice and be glad in it. So come what may. So come what may, it is well with me, and storms may rage. Oh, it is well with me, and still I will praise. It is well within my soul. It is well within my soul. So come, so.
Reads the blessing over us. Aaron Storman, who's one of our home group leaders here at James Island Christian Church. For those of you kind of new to what this looks like, we believe God gives us impressions, words, things that we can share. He's a living God. He speaks. And he felt like he had something for some folks this morning. So Aaron, why don't you come and share real quick?
Good morning, church. During worship and just at the start of the sermon, I felt like there was a word given to me. And then he gave me a picture after it. And the word is entrapment. He's saying that the deceiver, the accuser, has entrapped some of us into believing lies. And we've stopped lifting our eyes to see the truth. I don't know how many of us have believed lies before, just maybe one or two of us. And so he kept giving me the picture of what he gave me when I was saved. And so I'm just going to kind of paint that picture for you if you want to just take a second, close your eyes. I was trapped. And when I was praying, I was trying to figure out a way out. I was posturing and positioning, trying to look good. But the spiritual picture that my Savior gave me was me in a cell, in a dungeon, on the floor. And it was just black walls and like a chain around my ankle, ball of steel. And I was just, I didn't even know what to do anymore. I didn't even know. I was just like that despair in the heart. I was like, I don't know how to get out. I'll just paint it, make it look like it's a good place, right? But you can't really clean up a dungeon. And then Jesus came to the gate, to the wall, the bars of iron, and he, like, literally, the wall was removed. And he looked at me, and he did this. He went, he said, "Hey, are you coming?" And so I think what he's asking today is he's doing that. And who's believed a lie? Who's ready to have the King of Glory speak and the chain fall off? Jesus, I speak dominion over the lies of the enemy right now. Lord, I pray in the Holy Spirit that those of us who have believed lies would say, "I'm coming. Let me come. Take me." Lord, would you just let us lift our eyes to you? Let us take your hand. Lord, you said that you would give us the Holy Spirit. He would lead us into truth. He would walk us out. Lord, help us see where we are rightly. Holy Spirit, show us our deficiencies and where we're not measuring up, and realize that we're not the ones that have to fix it. You've given us the one that will come in, the helper, to raise us up and walk us out. Lord, would you do that today in Jesus' name?
Thank you, Aaron. And just as we close our time, this is like our formal close, but it's not, and we're not going anywhere. So if you need to respond to anything that the Lord has spoken through this time, we're going to be up here at the front. We'd love to talk with you and pray with you. As you leave, I want to pray a different blessing over you than I normally pray. I want to go back to Philippians 3. But whatever gain I had, I counted loss for the sake of Christ. Indeed, I count everything as a loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. For his sake, I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish in order that I may gain Christ and be found in him. Not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which comes through faith in Christ, the righteousness from God that depends on faith, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and may share in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, that by any means possible, I may attain the resurrection from the dead. Amen. Go in peace today. You're loved.